Speaking of traffic, I want to get to news that it's
broke
just,
this morning.
One of our very own Roz here is set to retire in 44 days.
Oh, yes. You're counting down the days.
We should put a countdown up
on
our little clock.
Yeah,
after 35 amazing years at ABC 7, Roz has decided to put the brakes on her daily traffic duties, and we are counting down to the big day.
And actually, Roz, we're going to hear from somebody this morning, very special, who knows you very well.
Uh-oh.
He has a message for you.
Uh-oh.
It's the end of an era. Chicago is ground zero for traffic reporting on television. She is the one who started it all for the entire country. So this is a big deal today. It's been 16 years. What an adventure that I've had to work with her.
Wow. Yeah. Well, I just got chills.
I know.
You don't get to see Bill very often. No. He is our traffic producer extraordinaire. So he is the man behind the magic.
There he is.
Yeah.
He is.
Yep.
Puts together all these maps for me, and we just kind of tag team as we're preparing traffic because it's too much for one person to do. When I'm back and forth in the studio every 10 minutes, which is actually less than 10 minutes, but I couldn't do it without him.
Yeah. He made a really good point in that you're an icon, of course, and we know you from your work on the air all these years, but you also started in a way that was groundbreaking for the technology at the time. Like, you started traffic in a city now where we do morning traffic, of course, is a part of newscasts all over the country, but you were a part of what started that, Roz.
You know, it's interesting. I had been doing radio traffic for 9 years, and I thought, there's got to be a way to make more money. Honestly. And
good for
so,
you.
But I thought, why can't I do this in television?
Yeah.
And Channel 7 was just, I got wind of this. They were getting ready to start this morning newscast. I heard about it in like November, December of 1988.
Mm-hmm.
And so I reached out to the news director at the time who was quitting. He was leaving, and he said, he talked to me, and he said, but here's the person. Tom Dolan is the person that you're going to want to talk to, and go ahead and put together a tape and resume, blah, blah, blah. And so I did, and there were maybe a handful of us from radio who auditioned for this job because it had never been done in television before.
Mm-hmm.
And all of us sucked. We were terrible. We were just, I mean, I didn't, chroma key, what is that? How do you point to a blank screen? Didn't know how to do any of that.
Yeah.
So we all auditioned, and none of us got hired. And I had to rethink it. And I'm like, okay, now I know what they're expecting.
Mm-hmm.
So I relied on my instructors from Columbia College.
Mm-hmm.
I had a teacher, Al Parker, who used to be the booth announcer here at Channel 7. When we had live booth announcers, they would do all of the announcing live.
Get out of here.
Seriously.
Wow. Ooh.
So he was a booth announcer here. He was one of my teachers. I took this class called Commercial Announcing, and I asked him what to do. How do I make a tape? How do I do this? I have never done that for TV before. So he put me in touch with some alum from Columbia who had a little production studio in the south suburbs, and I stood over the then Calumet Expressway, now the Bishop Ford Freeway, and I did what I do now, like a live traffic report on a bridge over an expressway, and they put little supers underneath with travel times.
Oh, cool.
And I turned in this tape. And I wrote this eloquent letter to Joe Ahern, general manager at the time, and said, look, I know that I really didn't give my best effort in that audition, but I know what you're looking for. I know I can do this. I can learn this. I can be on television just as good as anybody else who's been there for years.
Right. So, and look at this video we're looking at here, too, Roz.
Okay, so that video was when I had cancer.
Right. Yeah. I remember this.
Right?
Sarah.
And you know what? We whipped
Is
off our
Sarah?
Wigs. That's
yes.
Sarah. Look at that.
Get out of here.
I remember that.
Wow.
I took her wig shopping with me, and we both got wigs.
Yeah. Oh, my goodness. But you know what? That just let's just talk about that, too, how you share your personal journey battling cancer and becoming a survivor and how that touched so many of the viewers who could not only who maybe have been going through the struggle with you or a family member or whatnot and could relate to that, too.
You know who I shared that with who can relate to that is Tracy. Mm-hmm. And that makes me cry.
I know.
Mm-hmm. Look at the two of them.
I know. I'm sorry.
Don't look at each other.
Right.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Seriously, you'll start bawling. Yeah. I know.
But it's like traffic and weather really do go together when it comes to that. Mm-hmm. Because by being open about my breast cancer, I was diagnosed initially stage 4.
Right.
And that was in 2006. So it'll be 18 years this summer.
Wow.
18 years, you know, knock on wood, mm-hmm. right?
Yes.
That I'm a survivor. But by being approachable in that way, people who might be afraid or not know where to turn, I could be the conduit. I can help them. I can say, here's who you need to call. Here's where you need to go. Here's how you know, everybody handles cancer differently.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, some people don't want to talk about it.
Right.
Some people are very private about it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Some people want the world to know.
Yeah.
That'd be me.
Yeah.
But I do it that way because I know it can mm-hmm. help.
Mm-hmm.
So, if I could just say something about this lady. Of course, she is our traffic queen and whatever title you want to give to her. But, you know, reporting. The reports that she has done, whether it's, you know, the breast cancer walk or the Ride Janie Ride folks or something with Anti-Cruelty Society, a real talent of a reporter who is so good at their craft is somebody who can really write to video. Mm-hmm. This woman writes to video like,
nobody.
I mean, there are very few. Mm-hmm. And it really is a gift. And I know, and I say that because she didn't start out as a reporter and she shadowed Alan Krzyzewski, who was a genius, certainly, in our building. And Roz, the stories that you have brought us from the Holocaust Museum and the way you have just written your stories, it's a gift that I'm so grateful that you have shared with so many people.
Thank you for those kind words. You're making me blush. But I enjoy writing. I enjoy storytelling.
Yeah.
And it's kind of an acquired talent because I didn't always do that.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, as a young child, when I would have to write in grade school, I could never do it. We used to have vocabulary words.
And as a project,
a homework, we would have to write a story using those vocabulary words. And my mom would help me because I couldn't do it.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
I mean, she'd get me started.
Yeah.
And then I'd say, okay, then what, Mom?
Yeah.
And then what, Mom? Now what do I do, Mom? And I was afraid to write.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, the juxtaposition of turning, mm-hmm. doing this now as a profession and loving it.
And being really and good at it.
Really good. Really good at it.
We could spend 30 minutes more the rest of get him out, but I will have to say, as the newbie here, Roz is like one of the most thoughtful, generous people.
Amen.
Like, just I mean, the things that she does, and I mean, not on camera,
yeah.
not to be seen,
goes home and bakes for
muffins that I got this morning.
Yes,
yeah,
I mean, who does that?
Right,
who does that? So, anyway, we're gonna keep giving her her flowers over the next 44 days. This is just the beginning. We'll take a quick break, we'll be right back.
Good morning. Nice and quiet out there this morning. Just want you to know, tomorrow morning, we may start the day with a bit of rain in the area, and primarily areas south of I-80. There may even be a few thunderstorms, but then the weekend is going to be dry. Going to be chilly, though, Friday and Saturday. And we're also going to be watching kind of a little bit of a pattern shift into the middle of next week that could bring us rain and some storms as well. Well, our average high today is 38 degrees. Average low is 24. I mean, we're nowhere near any of those categories for today. 46 right now, the temperature out at O'Hare, and it is mostly cloudy. It is 47 degrees right here in Chicago. Roz?
We're going to start with a couple of suburban crashes. This one's in Addison, Army Trail and Swift. Big delay at that intersection. Then we've got a crash in Villa Park on Ardmore, just north of Division. That one is also causing some delays. And in Lombard, Main and Roosevelt, back up in all directions. As far as the expressways go, travel times are increasing. We're looking at 45 to 50 minutes as the average. We also still have this crash on the northbound Tri-State at 47th. Long delay there. We can see it on the tollway camera. It's bumper to bumper because we still have lane blockage there. Val and Terrell, back to you.
All right, Roz, thank you so much. A school athletic center is named in honor of the greatest. Muhammad Ali's eldest daughter recently visited a Villa Park school that honored her father's career in and out of the ring.
And as we honor Black History Month, Karen Jordan has the boxing legend's lasting impact on today's generation.
In honor of Black History Month, the Islamic Foundation School in Villa Park wanted to honor heavyweight champion and humanitarian Muhammad Ali. The guest speaker, his eldest daughter, Maryam Ali.
My father loved Chicago.
Who shared stories about her dad and all he accomplished outside of the boxing ring in a talk that was part history lesson, part motivational speech.
This is what made him very famous all over the world, is that there was this Black man in America that stood up to the U.S. government saying, I have a right to be Muslim, I have a right to not fight in this war.
His life inspired Ali to write a children's book called I Shook Up the World, The Incredible Life of Muhammad Ali. It was first published 20 years ago. Ali says she called her dad often when she was writing it. And today, it's finding new audiences.
And it's important to keep that legacy alive. But more than that, what can you extract from his life to apply it to your life?
The message seeming to resonate with students.
He would stand up to anyone, and he did it in a very convincing way. And he was really smart with his words, and I think we don't really appreciate that enough.
She gave really inspiring advice about how you should always, you know, succeed and set goals for yourself.
And as a bonus, the school's athletic center was named in honor of Muhammad Ali, with Maryam cutting the ribbon.
Very good. Thank you so much. Thank you.
A testament to Ali's lasting impact as a cultural icon. Karen Jordan, ABC 7 Eyewitness News.
Still to stream this morning, an event highlighting Chicago's up-and-coming Black filmmakers. You can discover it at the Music Box Theater.
Nope, I can't think of one thing.
All right, back at it. Beyonce, Queen B, is making history in the field of line dancing.
Yeah, the Beehive is abuzz this morning as she blazes yet another new trail with the song called Texas Hold'em. Saw this last night.
This ain't Texas.
I thought we were gonna see the dance.
Okay, go on your social media. It's everywhere. It's going viral. Beyonce has just become the first black woman to reach number one on the Billboard country chart.
Wow.
Country chart. Texas Hold'em also debuted number two on the Hot 100 chart. Meanwhile, her other country song, 16 Carriages, debuted at number nine. So there's a dance that goes with it.
Can you do the dance?
No, I was scrolling on the way to sleep, and I just got sleepy and put the phone down. But I'll work on it.
Yeah, I want to see it.
I do, too.
It's something like, well, no, not now. We're running, right, one little arm. Okay, we are celebrating Black History Month, and so is the Music Box Theater with some classics from African-American filmmakers and new work from Chicago directors.
Yeah, it's the Melanin Roots and Culture Festival. Jose Sanders talked to the local artist behind this whole thing.
I'm a Chicagoan. I ain't meant to be light. Develop the thickest skin from the windiest night.
We're talking about the importance of having people who love films to come see these productions. Why do you think that's so vital right now?
Right now, because representation is everything. And what I'm showing here is that our stories come from different realms, different experiences, as Black stories do.
Your father wouldn't put up with this mess. Do I look like my father?
Yeah, you do, man.
Pretty much in the nose.
Let's talk first about Barbershop. That was, of course, shot right here in Chicago.
It's just a real good film about Black camaraderie. Just seeing the conversations we have, having experiences, the good, the bad, the ugly.
You love your daddy, baby.
You know I do.
It's all I need.
I first found out about that film via a late great film critic, Roger Ebert, who was really a big fan of this movie.
In scene after scene, Eve's Bayou is simply mesmerizing. It's the kind of passionate family drama that coils around memory and mystery.
See, your dreams can offer important insights to how you view yourself and others.
Tell me about life within the lens and why you wanted to highlight some up-and-coming local talents.
These people are filmmakers who work for a certain amount of time. They're born and raised here.
Can't get out of my head, yeah. Maybe because I'm living my dream. Mm-hmm.
Reality raps. One for my baby.
It's tempting to look back and assume that our progress was inevitable.
Barat. Three really short films about love.
I'm Riri. I'm from the South Side, born and raised, and I am a liberal Republican.
What exactly is that?
A Black woman with a high-paying job.
Hindsight.
Why do you think it's so important that people come out and see these films?
It could definitely change and help mold the landscape of film in Chicago. The people who do work within the film industry and film students and film buffs do want to see something from Chicago artists, by Chicago artists. They'll come to the Music Box on March 6th.
Jose Sanders, ABC 7 Eyewitness News.
The movie Barbershop was showcased last night, Eve's Bayou Saturday, and the shorts from the up-and-coming Chicago Black filmmakers. And the Life Within the Lens showcase is Wednesday, March 6th.
Yeah, that's all at the Music Box Theater on Southport.
I want to get to this next story. The world's tallest living man has been reunited with the world's shortest living woman. Sultan Kusin and Jyoti Amga met for breakfast in California on Monday. The last time they met was in 2018. What? Sultan stands nearly 8 feet, 3 inches tall. Jyoti is a little over 2 feet tall.
What?
Sultan is 4 times taller than her.
More, a little bit more.
Oh my God.
8'3".
Wow.
Yeah, wow. I think it's more than that, yeah.
What in the world?
It's unbelievable.
What is he, 8 foot something?
He's eight foot three.
Wow.
Which has got to be a lifestyle all in itself.
Yeah.
Both of them, to be honest with you.
Yeah, yeah, he needs that cane. He's young. He needs that cane.
Cane,
I mean,
yeah,
you just think about your joints and your limbs.
Yep.
Sure.
That have grown like that. Mm-hmm. Wow, I thought 7'7". What was Yao Ming was? How old was Yao Ming? Hey, Siri, how tall was Yao Ming?
Yao Ming is 7 feet, 6 inches.
Seven, six.
Wow.
Right. And how tall is Wimby?
Wimby, 7'7".
7'7", okay, got it.
And Taco Fall is 7'6".
So 8'3"?
Rattle off these
things, yeah.
You forgot who I'm married to?
Yeah, right.
Right. Anytime there's a basketball player, I've likely heard it and then just retained it somewhere in my memory, but I'll release it later.
That is something.
Wow.
Yeah, isn't that crazy?
Yeah, I mean, let's think. You can't get into
that
door.
Through a normal door, get into a normal bed.
No. Know,
all that is just...
How do you sit on the toilet?
I know.
Oof, it's a lot.
I didn't even think about that part.
Yeah, because your feet, you're going to hang off.
Exactly.
You need an extra long toilet.
Underwear, T-shirts, shoes, socks. You're right. Before we go this hour, I got a story about a bus driver going the extra mile for a student. David Muir has this story in case you missed it on World News last night.
In Louisville, the elementary school bus driver who cares about the children on his bus, he noticed something. Larry Ferris Jr. has been driving for Engelhard Elementary School for years. He's beloved. They call him Mr. Larry. When Mr. Larry picked up first grader Levi Carrier, he knew something was wrong. Levi was in tears, telling Mr. Larry it was pajama day at school and he didn't have any to wear. Mr. Larry dropping off the students and then going to Family Dollar himself, where he bought two pairs of PJs for Levi, hoping one of them would work. Tonight, the school is sharing the story, saying Levi and his family are grateful. Levi saying Mr. Larry is nice and his heart is filled with joy. Right here tonight.
Good evening, Mr. David.
That bus driver, Mr. Larry.
We can educate and further push our kids in the right direction. Our school staff, our bus drivers, our principals, our teachers, they all go above and beyond doing for our kids every single day.
And tonight we have learned, following Mr. Larry's lead, the community now coming together, a local nonprofit raising money for Levi and his family to go shopping for new clothes. And Mr. Larry, the bus driver, says he will be right there with them.
My small gesture has become a huge impact, and I'm so grateful for it. Have a good one. Thanks for talking to me.
Wow.
Larry.
Isn't that great? Big thanks to David for that report. That's just awesome. Awesome. I'm glad we're telling stories like that, too.
Yeah. Yes. More
of those.
Right, exactly.
All right, well, that's going to wrap up this Weepy Streaming Hour for Tracy and Roz. I'm Val Warner.
And I'm Terrell Brown. Appreciate you watching the news at 7. I'm going to have a news update. There's going to be weather and traffic checks in there, too. We're going to hear from everybody in just a moment. From everyone here at ABC 7, have a great day, everybody. We'll see you back here same time tomorrow, 7 a.m.